Hi friends and welcome to another video. My name is Julie if you're new here, and today I'm going to give you 5 Christmas romance recommendations. We have a little bit of a different background going on right now because I'm at my mom's house and I'm spending Christmas here. So that's why we have a different background, but also I tried recording this video earlier and I made the really stupid mistake to record the whole video in slow-mo. So now I have footage without any sound. But I did record this video before, so yeah, I'm just going to tell you everything again, really. That's fine. We're going to make it work. I tried to bring on a little bit of a Christmas mood in the background with the candles, but honestly, there's not much of a Christmas mood going on in this house. My mom's not really a big fan of putting up a Christmas tree and everything, so I'm just keeping it really light on the traditional stuff. But we have a little candle to bring us up a Christmas mood. Also, I have a cold, so that's why I'm speaking a bit quieter, I hope. It doesn't make too much of a difference. But just in case you're wondering why I sound a little bit different. We only have a few days left until Christmas. Actually, just 2. So, if you're not already in a Christmas mood and need to get in a Christmas mood, these reads are going to be perfect for you, I promise. Or if you're already in a Christmas mood and you just want to keep going for a little longer, and just maybe need a few more recommendations even though you have already been reading Christmas romance, I hope there are a few in here that can still surprise you. So let's get right into it. The first book I want to tell you about is by one of my favorite romance authors in general, and this is the coziest romance series that I know of. It always gives me such a good mood. It makes me so happy to read these. And honestly, this one gave me so much of a Christmas mood. I was so giddy after reading this already, even though it was the first one that I read. It is The Christmas Castle in Scotland by Julie Kaplan. And Julie Kaplan just has perfected this way of describing everything in a really cozy way. So if you're into really relaxing, non-dramatic reads, then this one is definitely for you. This book is about Izzy, and Izzy has actually inherited a castle from, I think it was her uncle who passed away, and now she gets to have this castle and live in it with her mom, because her mom actually got promised that she can live in there. But Izzy's plan is to flip this castle into a hotel. And when she arrives in the castle, there actually is the guy standing in her kitchen, and she's like, "What the heck are you doing here?" And then he's like, "I can't live here. That's why I'm in the kitchen." And she's like, "What? But we don't have any guests yet. We can't even take any guests yet. We are not finished with any of the renovations." And her mom basically just found this random guest and he's now staying in the hotel. Also, her mom is a bit chaotic. And she has to deal with that. And her mom actually found this really rich guest who is going to stay with this whole family over the Christmas holidays. And that's only a few weeks away. And as I just said, they haven't done any of the renovations. Castle is not ready to be a hotel. So they need to finish all of that before the holidays begin. And of course, that's really stressful. And also something that always comes up in Julie Kaplan romance novels, at least in this series, is the theme of food. So she's also preparing a lot of food, really traditional stuff, and she learns basically how to cook all of this stuff, and it's really just so cute and wholesome. Wholesome is the vibe that I would describe this book with. And of course, the guys staying at the castle, they didn't get along in the beginning because she didn't expect them to be there. She was a bit rude because of that. He just was like, "I am an author, I want to stay here so I can write my novel. I don't want to be disturbed by anyone, leave me alone." And she's like, "Nah, actually I want to kick you out." But in the end she doesn't, and these two get along pretty well. So yeah, that's the story. There's also a lot more going on in the castle. They are searching for this hidden jewels that are supposed to be somewhere in the castle, and it's just that's something that I really like, that there's always so much subplot going on. It's not just focused on the relationship, but it's also around this castle and the story behind it, the found family and that the people in the castle have, the people that she takes in there, and there's just so much going on and I love it. I'm so here for it. It really gives you all the Christmas vibes. So after the first successful novel, I read Love Light Farms by B.K. Barson. This book you might have already heard about. It's pretty popular, I would say, on BookTok and BookTube. It is about Stella, and Stella owns this farm. And she has some financial problems, which is why she entered this competition. And in this competition, she can win a lot of money. She can win, I think, around $10,000 or something, and she can also get exposure by this influencer, Evelyn. And Evelyn is coming to the farm to actually look around and see what's going on. And the problem is that Stella put in her application that she owns this farm with her boyfriend. Problem is, she doesn't have a boyfriend. So what could be a solution to that? Stella goes on and asks her best friend Luca if he can step in and be her best boy. Her best boyfriend. Wow, he's her best friend. And she asks him to be her fake boyfriend. But Stella actually has feelings for Luca. So she's trying to just take the opportunity and enjoy life while these two just go around town, pretend that they are dating. Another problem comes up when Luca's mom finds out about this, because this is a small town, obviously everybody's going to know about this. And yeah, so they also have to pretend in front of his family, and just lots of complications there because of the real feelings and fake relationship, blah blah blah. You know where this is going. What I also really liked about this was that there was also a really relevant subplot. There was this plot of someone who tries to sabotage Stella's farm, and she tries everything to make this farm as good as possible. She really gives her best, she really cares about her employees, and that's just the spirit of Christmas for me. Like how much she tried to step in for them, make them not feel how they supported her throughout all of these struggles, and yeah, that's just so cute. Also, what could be better than a farm at Christmas? Snow and everything, just the best vibes. So yeah, this book, Love Light Farms, also a huge recommendation. The third book that I want to recommend to you is one that I didn't actually think I would like. I thought that I would really not enjoy this, but I did give it a try anyways. And the reason why I did not think I would enjoy it is that it has the billionaire's trope. And that's something that I have a little bit of a personal struggle with. I don't tend to enjoy it that much because it tends to be really misogynistic and just so unrealistic. But for some reason in this book I felt like it was fine. It wasn't the best ever, like in terms of equality and the dynamics of the relationship, but I felt like it did so much better than all of the billionaire's romances that I have ever read. So that says something. The book that I am talking about is Hot-Blooded, High-Powered by Susan Mallory. This is about the billionaire Duncan and about Annie. Annie's brother actually works for Duncan, and Duncan is the CEO of this huge company that, of course, he has built up by himself. Duh. And he is kind of not the best type of guy. He is not treating his employees that well. He's not being nice to anyone, really. He's just thinking about the business and the way he can bring his company forward without stopping and thinking about what that means for other people around him. If somebody does something that he doesn't like, he just tries to buy them, basically, or get his way in another way. And that's kind of what he also tries with Annie's brother and Annie. because Annie's brother has taken some money from the company because he has a gambling problem. Duncan turns up at Annie's house because Annie's brother has actually told Duncan that this house belongs to him and that he can give it to Duncan. But it's actually Annie's house and she can't give it away. And then Duncan's like, oh, well, if you can't give me the money, if you can't give me your house, then your brother is just going to jail. So what do you think? And Annie's like, oh, I really want to help my brother. Is there any other way? Like, I need to support my family. They are living in this house. My cousins are living here. I need to take care of them as well. And I can't possibly give you this house. And then he's like, you seem to be a really nice and good person. You're trying to help your family, you're trying to help your brother. And my manager, my uncle, told me that I need a good girl on my side. So can you come to all of these events with me in preparation for Christmas time and make me look like a good guy? And she's like, doesn't sound like too bad of a deal. And he's like, yeah, I will then send your brother to rehab and he can just fairly pay off his debts. And she's like, rehab, sounds good. And then they agree on this and she decides to fake date him. And they go to all of these events, he buys her all of the stuff. And of course, while they're fake dating, she realizes that he isn't just behaving this way out of nowhere. There's actually a reason behind his behavior and he isn't actually such a bad guy because he actually listens to her and he kind of does what she tells him to do, like helping his employees and stuff, and she's really helping him to become a better man. And yeah, that's also what I liked about this, is that he really treated her with respect. The money never really was the main thing that was a conflict in her relationship and wasn't the main thing that solved the relationship. It didn't play that much of a role, except that he bought her lots of nice stuff. And not even just her, but also her cousins. And that was kind of wholesome. And in the meantime, she does things for him as well, like teaching him the spirit of Christmas, for example. I did think the third eye conflict was maybe a bit weird. Didn't feel like it was really realistic. But I still enjoyed it a lot. And even though the Christmas vibes weren't that obvious, not as obvious as in the other two books, I still thought they were there and kind of had the spirit of Christmas. And I felt like it was a refreshing take on a Christmas romance. So if that sounds like you could enjoy it, check out this book by Susan Mallory. The next book is one with one of the cheesiest Christmas tropes that you could probably think of. It really has this Hallmark movie vibe. It's called The Christmas Cabin and it is by J.L. Jarvis. This book is about a lawyer from New York City who goes to this Christmas cabin out in the woods in the middle of nowhere to spend her Christmas. She works really hard and she has worked so hard for this vacation and she's really successful as well. She's trying to get a partner at her firm and she just wants this week until New Year's Eve because she doesn't want to spend Christmas with her family because they're going on this cruise, blah blah blah. So Abby arrives at this Christmas cabin and she realizes when she enters the house that the heating isn't working and it's really cold outside, it's Christmas. So she tries to call the owner of this cabin and she calls him like 1,000 times. I actually think she's drinking a bit of wine as well. And then she falls asleep when he arrives. And a while later she wakes up by somebody knocking on her door. Who could it be? The owner of the house who's come to repair her heating. Very nice guy, his name is Jack. And then the tropiest thing ever happens and they get snowed in the cabin and that's why he has to stay there and that's how they get to know each other. And they turn out to really like each other. But then again, Abby is from the Big Apple and she has no reason to stay there for any longer than this week. And he has his family back there and his whole life. He's a forest ranger. He just belongs out there. And now the question is, what's going to happen after this week? And actually I thought, even though this has this Hallmark movie trope, this book was actually pretty good. It was solid. It had a solid development, solid plot structure, and even though it was really, really short, it still managed to make me believe in this relationship, and I could see these two really be together, which I really enjoyed. And also the way the conflict was solved in the end was really enjoyable. I would really recommend this, especially if you like Hallmark movies and tropey things. And we are already at our last recommendation. The last book that I want to recommend to you is actually the sixth part of a series, but you don't have to read any of the other books before you read this one. I only read the first three before I read this one, and I still enjoyed it a lot. Without knowing all of the context, it's like one of those where it tells the story of the whole family and basically the whole town in different books. So you get the different couples in different books. And this one is called Mistletoe Magic by Kelly Moran. It's part of the Redwood Rich series. This one is Redwood Rich 6. And actually all of these books take place in the small town Redwood, where everybody knows everyone. And in this town there's the Dragon Trio. These are three aunts who basically are the matchmakers in town. They always try to bring all of these different people together, and they're like really good at it, and everybody's a little bit annoyed by them, but still it works. This time it's actually the other way around. Somebody is trying to find someone for Marie, who is part of this dragon trio. And Marie has this old flame that has come back to town. His name is Preston. And Marie really doesn't want to see Preston. She has avoided him since he has arrived in town, because they have been together before and they have actually been engaged. But then Preston decided to go away. He's decided to leave Redwood and live his own life and build his business and everything. He had a few hotels, and now he's come back to Redwood and has his hotel there. And she's like, no, I don't want to see him. He broke my heart. I don't want to talk to him really. Even though he has actually spent a lot of time thinking about her, apparently, because he has written her a card every single birthday or every single Christmas, I think. And now that the Christmas celebration is coming up, the people in town kind of make these two work together. So it is a second chance romance. And they don't realize it, but people are always making up these excuses to leave them two alone, and they have to kind of overcome their old problems together, and they have to find a way how to communicate and, yeah, kind of also find out why things didn't work out. And I think this book is really for you if you like the small town vibes, because this is the standout thing about this series, really, that it is set in this really small town where everybody knows everyone and people are just way too happy for some reason. They all have this, like, they all find the love of their life, and yeah, that's how it works in Redwood. I would say I wouldn't recommend this book to people who don't like miscommunications in relationships and second chance romances because of that, because this one definitely has that. And I usually don't enjoy that much, but I still like this book. This tends to be a theme of these Christmas romances, right? Tropes that I usually don't like becoming something I like. Maybe it has to do with Christmas. So yeah, if you would like a small town romance with a really cheesy plot and just happy characters, good vibes, and some matchmaking, then I would really recommend this one as well. These were my five Christmas romance recommendations. I hope you found something for the days before Christmas and maybe also the holidays. And I really wish you a Merry Christmas if you celebrate. See you in my next video. Bye!